But first, we step back for a fuller explanation of how the exchanges should work. One state has already been running its own insurance marketplace for years, and in many ways, it has served as a model for the new ones. Economics correspondent Paul Solman reports from Massachusetts. It's part of his ongoing reporting, Making Sense of Financial News.
In 1997, I was diagnosed with breast cancer after a routine mammogram. Okay,
Boston filmmaker Deb Dorsey, whose health nightmare became a documentary.
I went through 4 rounds of chemotherapy and 6 weeks of radiation. Then it turned out that the adriamycin that they had given me with the chemotherapy had done damage to my heart, and I went into heart failure. They said, we think you're a candidate for a pacemaker.
Dorsey had health insurance through the company she owned with her filmmaker husband, who freelances for the NewsHour. But when the business tanked, Dorsey's prior conditions put her in peril.
Me without insurance would have been a disaster because nobody would have insured me.
Disaster didn't happen. Dorsey could buy insurance because of the Massachusetts health law, signed by Republican Governor Mitt Romney in 2006, and its online marketplace, the Health Connector, where some 250,000 people now get insurance from 9 private companies. It's the model for the state exchanges being set up under the Affordable Care Act. So, what is the connector, and how has it worked?
Good afternoon. Thank you for calling the Health Connector.
At a Boston call center which fields consumer questions, the connector's executive director, Jean Yang, described it this way.
The experience that you get is not going to be that different from when you typically go to an e-commerce website where consumers can easily browse, compare options, and complete a transaction. And then that fosters competition, so it eventually it leads to a more efficient market.
You can look for health insurance for individuals and families, employers who want to shop for their businesses, and for brokers.
MIT economist John Gruber, who helped craft the connector, gave us a walkthrough.
So let's say it's just you as an individual.
Okay, then it's going to ask about my income. And the reason is because if I'm low income, I'm eligible for special subsidies to the low income families.
Got it.
I'm not, so I'm going to continue.
Then you type in your zip code and your birthday.
Okay, now it's retrieving my available plans and rates.
The connector has different levels of choices. That'll be the case in other states, too. Bronze has the lowest premiums or upfront costs, but higher out-of-pocket costs when you receive care. Silver and gold are next, and the Affordable Care Act adds platinum, which has the most expensive premiums but lowest out-of-pocket.
A platinum plan, which is the highest tier, the insurance plan will be covering 90% of the cost, where a consumer will be responsible for 10%. A gold plan is 80% cost assumed by the insurance company, and a silver is 70 and a bronze is 60.
Within the metallic tiers, insurance companies offer competing plans. The benefits are the same, but prices vary, based in part on which doctors and hospitals participate. But it wasn't always this simple.
We started with very much a any willing plan model.
So I would have gone to the website and I would have just seen plan after plan after plan after
Correct.
Plan.
Correct, yes. And it very quickly became too confusing. So we standardized our product design. You know, what is covered, what is not covered, how much is covered? If I go see a doctor, if I go to the emergency room, how much am I supposed to pay? It's the same.
By contrast, the new federally run exchanges will not require that plans have the same features, at least not at first.
Hi, Phoebe.
MIT's Gruber shares his home in Lexington, Massachusetts, with more than a few feathered friends. Among them, Phoebe the cockatoo.
Phoebe's going to live about 100 years.
We mention Phoebe as a reminder that long life is a key economic good, but it tends to require health care, which for most of us requires insurance. So from his economics perch, Gruber's connector was first and foremost about insuring the uninsured.
However, you can't just do that in a vacuum, because if you tell insurers you have to insure everyone at the same price, but people can wait till they're sick to buy insurance, they'll lose money and get out of the business.
Insuring everyone, therefore, is just the first leg of a three-legged stool.
So you can't get the first goal without a second leg of the stool, and that's the individual mandate. Individuals, you make sure you buy health insurance sick or healthy. But then the third leg of the stool is the government needs to make this system work by making insurance affordable.
While some of the uninsured are healthy and young, some are poor and sick. yet can't afford insurance. So the connector subsidizes them based on income.
Come on up, we'll check your blood pressure.
Today, 97% of Massachusetts residents have insurance, the highest rate in the country. But that's caused other problems.
Who's going to take care of these patients?
Richard Dupuy, an internist and chief of geriatrics at Tufts Medical Center.
We're really covering more of the population. We don't have enough physicians to do it. So as a result, patients are ending up in clinics and waiting to be seen. Many are going to the emergency room with their insurance card, but waiting to be seen.
And that's another problem. Reform hasn't reduced expensive ER visits as much as hoped, since many newly insured now go there for care.
The reason for that is we don't have enough primary care doctors, and we also have a lot of physicians who feel that the reimbursement structure for patients who are in the connector is not sufficient to be able to help them support their practice overhead.
It's just they're not going to get paid enough money.
Yeah, they feel the payment is inadequate.
But Dupuy's 6,000 patient practice is big enough to absorb new subsidized patients.
Oh, you're welcome. We'll see you Friday.
Even if he's paid less to see them.
Come on down here with me, honey.
Plus, he's helping people.
I've seen a ton of new patients, all of whom were pretty sick or were going to be sick. And now they're not. For example, they'd come in and they get their physical, and they'd find out their cholesterol is over 300, and they never knew that. Their blood pressure is 160 over 100. They never knew that. And now it's all controlled.
But medical costs continue to climb in Massachusetts, which still spends more on health care than any state in the country. So what does all this imply for the success of exchanges in other states? We ask the Birdman of Lexington.
The effectiveness of this law depends on broad participation. That requires outreach and social agreement to be part of this new social contract where everyone gets health insurance. That worked in Massachusetts. We ran ads between the first and second inning of every Red Sox game in the summer of 2007.
The state's health connector has affordable plans, lots to choose from, and easy sign up.
No one ran ads saying don't get health insurance. There were no protests. That may not be true in some of these states.
Indeed. It already isn't.
I see you chose to sign up for Obamacare.
As this ad from a group called Generation Opportunity makes clear.
If they convince healthy people to stay out of the pool, that raises rates for everyone else and makes the law less successful.
On the other hand, some 24 million people like Deb Dorsey are expected to get insurance through an exchange over the next 2 years.
I have to have insurance. I have a pacemaker. It costs money. I have to see my oncologist once a year. I have medication that I'm on that I have. It's expensive. That can be very, very expensive.
But as more people needing expensive care sign up for insurance, the system's success will depend on getting the young and healthy to sign up too.